Let us now listen to God's word as we start our service. We turn to Psalm 117. It's actually the shortest psalm that we have. And let me read those two verses, page 605 in your Bibles. Praise the Lord, all nations. Extol him, all peoples. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Let us sing now. Our opening song is Rejoice 330, God Himself is Present.
Gracious Lord and loving, wonderful, eternal, heavenly Father, what a privilege it is to come before you this morning, Lord. How grateful we are that we can come before you and talk to you, Lord, as we are, the Creator, the King, the Lord, the God of the universe, Lord, and we can come into your presence. How marvellous it is, and we come, Lord, and can we only come in and through the precious name of Jesus, who bore our sins, our iniquities, in his body on the cruel tree, Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you, thank you, thank you. And forgive us our sins and our shortcomings and our failings, Lord. We know we fail you so often in so many ways, Lord. We say things we shouldn't. We don't say things we should. We think things we shouldn't, Lord. But you know it all. And you're a forgiving and loving God, Lord. And as far as the east is from the west, so far have you removed our transgressions from us. We love you, Lord. We want to love you more. Help us to love you more. Help us to love each other more, Lord. Quicken us. Draw us. Call us. We know that you are here this morning, Lord. Where two or three are gathered together, there you are in the midst, and that's a bless. And we know you are here. We do pray for John as he preaches to us, Lord. Give us listening ears. Speak to our hearts, Lord, as he expounds your your precious word, Lord, your inspired word about this wonderful man, Joseph. We pray for John, and we thank you for him, Lord. And we thank you for Allan, and we thank you for John Cromarty. We thank you for Neil, for the elders and those who are looking after us spiritually, Lord. We thank you for them. Above all, we thank you for you. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for caring for us. We thank you for choosing us. We thank you for speaking to our hearts. And Lord, we pray for those who we love, who don't know you. And Lord, we're so concerned for them, Lord, but we know that only you, Lord, can work in them and speak to them, Lord. But help us to play our part as well. Now we commit this service to you. Without you, we can do nothing. And we know that, Lord, and we just leave it with you, and we leave everything with you as best we can. Be with us now. Thank you for your love. For Jesus' sake, amen.
We come now to the memory verse, where we each week look at a verse. We normally do it a month at a time. We're perhaps a week or two over it. We're looking at the first two verses of Romans chapter 12. So we say it again together, Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Now, John and I have been explaining parts of this verse over the past few weeks. John last week concentrated on the final phrase, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Today, I want to put that in its context in Romans 12. That's not all that Paul says regarding it, because he goes on to show how we are to discern the will of God and the things that affect various parts of our lives. See, Paul is saying you have to be renewed. You have to be transformed. And it's your mind that is involved. You have to think through these things. What then are we to do? And Paul says, for the grace of God given to me, I say to everyone, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. So Paul is going on to explain what he has said already in verses 1 and 2. If you look at Romans 12, you find that verses 3 to 8, he speaks about the humble gifts that are within the Christian fellowship. We have to remember that we are one body, and we are individually members one of another. We've got different gifts. We can see that in our own fellowship here. There are some who have one gift, some that have another. Every one of us has a gift that can be used in the service of God. And then in verses 9 to 13, Paul goes on to say, you have to remember also that there are loving acts of service and of hospitality that you are to show. He speaks about setting aside what is evil, loving one another with brotherly affection, all these very practical things that flow from the fact that you are transformed and yet you are different from those of the world. And then later in the chapter, in verses 14 to 21, he says that you are to live in imitation of Christ's teaching. And especially if you look at those verses, you see that it's the Sermon on the Mount that he picks up there again. Bless those who persecute you, bless and don't curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. And then later on he says, don't repay evil for evil. Now you see, that is what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount. So what I'm suggesting this morning is that the first two verses flow through then into the rest of that chapter in very practical ways. You may say, well, what do I do about things that are not mentioned here? I say, you think what are the aspects of general teaching that Jesus gave, and you have to, with your mind, think, how can I apply that teaching to this situation in which I'm faced? Now, I know that I've seen in books, and perhaps especially in children's books, people will say that you stop and think, what would Jesus do? The trouble with that is nowhere mentioned in the New Testament as a suitable way to act, because I might be wrong. I might think to myself, what would Jesus do in that situation, and act upon it, and it might be quite different from what the biblical teaching is. So set that aside and say there are two things. One is that we follow the directions that have been given, such as here in Romans 13 and following, or in the other teaching parts of the New Testament. And then in other situations, we have to stand back, think through what God has taught us in his word, and see how things apply in various situations. So here we have this lovely teaching by Paul. You're to be different from the world. You're not to be conformed. You're to be transformed. And then you are to apply that in your everyday lives, that you may show that you truly love and serve the Saviour. So we say again, Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Now I've chosen as the hymn to be sung now, one that speaks about following the perfect way. Comes from a psalm, we're singing Rejoice 437. Teach me, O Lord, the perfect way.
In your good and holy.
read now the New Testament reading. We turn to page 1204 to 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 to 25. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 to 25. Hear the word of the Lord. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honourable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme, or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honour everyone. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honour the emperor. Servants, be subject to your own masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. For this is a gracious thing, when, mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if, when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if, when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. May God add his blessing to that reading of his word. Now, in coming to our pastoral prayer, there are a couple of things that I want to mention. I want to pray for Alistair McEwen as he recovers from COVID, and hope that in God's grace he has no lasting effects from that, but he's able to quickly resume work and resume preaching for us. There are others in the congregation who are unwell as well, and I want to pray that God's grace will be shown to them. We pray for those away on holiday and ask that they may have a good and a refreshing time. We are following now the custom of praying for some overseas Christians, and you'll normally see it as the last item under the supplications on the final page of the bulletin. And today we're going to pray for the persecuted Christians in Sri Lanka and the Christian organisations trying to help them during these extremely trying times in that country. Some of you who have had a connection with Geelong West Church in the past know Derek and Heather Davey. Their son Cameron and his wife and children have been serving as missionaries in Sri Lanka and are still there. They expect to leave in September, so I'm going to pray for them particularly that they won't be caught up in any of the demonstrations that are taking place politically at the moment, and be able to get all their final details sorted out as they leave to come back to Australia. Let me lead you in prayer now. Heavenly Father, we come here this morning to bless you. Oh, how gracious you are. You do not look upon us as we are by nature, but in the Lord Jesus, you look upon us as redeem sinners who have been brought to love and to serve you through the work of your Spirit in our hearts. Thank you for the profession that we have made of commitment to Christ. May we know what it is to live before the watching world in a way that is honouring to you and that brings the greater glory to your name. We pray for those in the congregation who have been unwell. We pray too for Alistair McEwen, praying that he'll recover quickly from the COVID and soon will be able to resume his normal work and ministry, and that we look forward to seeing him back here with us, opening up the Word of God. We pray for those of our number who are away on holiday. We pray that they'll have a refreshing time and that they'll meet up with Christians where they are and be blessed by fellowship with them. We ask, Heavenly Father, for your grace to be upon your church in Sri Lanka. We know of the persecution that Christians have faced there, of the difficulties that they have had of maintaining public services. We pray particularly for Cameron Davey and his wife and family. Lord, keep them safe and bless them at this time and help them as they prepare to come back to Australia in September. Lord, may the work that they've done there continue to be blessed as they have taught and sought to lead others in the way of truth and righteousness. We pray for other missions that we know there too. Thank you for those who have come to faith in Christ and who are prepared to make a stand for the gospel in their own land. Lord, we pray for the neighbouring country of India, where there has been also so much persecution against Christians. We pray, Lord, that you will sustain your church. We pray that there may be a greater outreach from the Indian Christians themselves, not in dependence upon foreign missionaries or servants who come, but may they themselves be able to show to others what it is to live for the Lord Jesus, and may they have the opportunities to teach and to expound your word to them, that they may come to faith in Christ. Lord, we pray for the work here in Australia of training for the ministry and for the mission field. We pray for RTC and PTC in particular, the colleges that we have special interest in and are local to us. We ask, Lord, that you will bless those who teach and those who are taught, that they may be instructed together and blessed together as they work on things relating to Scripture and to the history of your church and to the way of presenting the gospel here in Australia. Lord, make us fruitful in the work of your kingdom. We are weak and frail. We can do nothing of ourselves. We depend upon you and upon your strength and your grace. Bless us, we pray, this week. Each week reminds us that we are to number our days so that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Grant that we may know what it is to walk in the light of your word and to honour you in what we do. We thank you for gathering us here this morning, and we pray for blessing upon us as we further sing and as John preaches to us. Lord, may that be a word that is appropriate to us today. May it speak to our hearts. May we be blessed by it. Help us, we pray, to let your word live in our hearts and our lives day by day. Bless our homes, bless each one of us in our individual situations, and help us, we pray, day by day to be faithful servants of him who has given himself for us, who laid down himself upon the cross of Calvary that we might have life. Hear our prayer now and bless us, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. While the offering is taken, we're going to sing again to God's praise. We're going to sing from Rejoice 79, and the offering will be taken, and it will stand at the last verse, number 79 in Rejoice.
Merciful.
Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for those words that we have just sung. We have prayed that we will stand firm and strong in praise to you. May that be true. We come to confess you again this morning, to present ourselves and our gifts for the work of your kingdom. Lord, as you have blessed us, we bring our gifts for your work, praying that they may be used here for the work of ministry among us. Thank you for the regular meetings we have and the service, the Bible study, the fellowship. Thank you also that we have opportunity to give to work of missions here in Australia and overseas. Lord, help us to give with joyful hearts to your work. Bless us then now, we pray. Speak to us through the word of truth, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's turn to our Old Testament reading in the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 39. And we'll take up the reading at verse 11. This is the word of God. Let us give our attention to it. But one day, when he went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house was there in the house, she caught him by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand and fled and got out of the house. And as soon as she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and had fled out of the house, she called to the men of her household and said to them, "See, he has brought among us a Hebrew to laugh at us. He came in to me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice. And as soon as he heard that I lifted up my voice and cried out, he left his garment beside me and fled and got out of the house." And she laid up his garment by her until his master came home. And she told him the same story, saying, "The Hebrew servant who you have brought among us came in to me to laugh at me. But as soon as I lifted up my voice and cried, he left his garment beside me and fled out of the house." As soon as his master heard the words that his wife spoke to him, "This is the way your servant treated me," his anger was kindled. And Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in prison. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favour in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever was done there, he was the one who did it. The keeper of the prison paid no attention to anything that was in Joseph's charge, because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it succeed. Let us pray. Again, we give you thanks for your word, O Father. We thank you that it is a living word, powerful in the hand of your Spirit, searching into our hearts, revealing truth there, exposing error and sin, things that we have sought to cover up or ignore. For you are a God who delights in righteousness, who promotes godliness in the life of his servants. You want to walk with us. You want us to walk with you. We cannot walk together unless we agreed, not on our terms, but your terms. We know that this is only in Christ that it is possible. Because of Christ, it is actual for those who have believed. And so, as your servants, trusting in Christ, We pray that you would bring this word to bless us in our lives, that you would strengthen the principle of faithfulness, the commitment to holiness, the delight in walking in your ways, that you would come with mercy amongst us by your Spirit and teach us and strengthen our faith and assure us that you are a God who is with us, whose mercy rests upon us, who prospers all that we do to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Last time we left off the record of Joseph's life with his own words, surely ringing in our hearts as to how we should respond to temptation. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? To Joseph, temptation was a great wickedness, a great evil. The particular temptation was not simply an affair. It was an assault upon the glory of God, the will of God. This is how he viewed sin. Is it how we view sin? Surely today it seems that sin is very little thought of. And if it is, it's often reconstructed as that which is good. But the Christian, we, like Joseph, must testify that it is evil, and we must bear testimony to the enormity of its evilness, that it's not only destructive, as here destructive of relationships, as Joseph testifies concerning marriage, as he testifies concerning his working life, his relationship with his master. He also sees it as an unholy assault against a holy God. It's a defiance of his authority. It's an abuse of his goodness. It's a rejection of his mercy. There is nothing more wicked than the smallest sin, except other sins. And that's how we should view it. To those who make light of sin, surely the words of Charles Simeon stand as a stark warning when he says, "Let us remember that fleshly lusts war against the soul," which he quotes from 1 Peter 2:11, "and that either we must mortify and subdue them, or they will enslave and destroy us. For even though the whole universe should combine to justify the commission of sin, not one who yields to its solicitations shall ever pass unpunished." That's a lesson we need to learn every day. And it's a wonderful grace of God if you know something of the evil and malignancy of sin. And now it's an even greater mercy if in his grace God has called you to look to Christ, to lift your eyes unto him in faith, to find forgiveness, to receive assurance that through his sacrifice upon the cross, through his shed blood, your sin, though scarlet, is washed away, and in the sight of God, through union to Christ, you are as white as snow. He made atonement for our sin. He has broken the power of sin. And as we looked at that passage, not only though do we see the horror of sin and the sublime answer to that sin in Christ, we also see a great source of encouragement to us as we face temptation in various forms at different times in our day, day after day. That in our battle against sin, we see that no matter how intense the assault, how weak we may feel, whether it's from without or of sin within, there is no inevitability in us to fall to sin. We can resist the evil one and he will flee from us because of Christ in us. We can do what is right. We too are able to resist, for God does not allow us, as Paul reminds us, in 1 Corinthians 10, to be tempted beyond what we are able to endure. We have the resources in the Holy Spirit, and the Word of God is the sword of the Spirit. And on top of that, God always, Paul tells us, provides a way of escape. You may not see it initially, but as we look to Christ, as we trust in the power of the Holy Spirit, the way will be made clear. The question is not one of ability, but one of commitment, of determination to honour God in our lives, to be obedient. It's a powerful picture that we have in the life of Joseph, and what a fitting prefigure that is of the Lord Jesus Christ, who was perfect without sin. But in the light of that, what are we to make of what happened next? For it's not a pleasant picture, is it? He has honoured God. He has been resolute in obedience. He has sacrificed the little comforts and growths personally for the sake of moral integrity, for the sake of not slandering the name of his God, by submitting to the whim and the will of the one who was tempting him. What are we to make then of what happens next? Well, as we look at it, I want to remind you first of all of the continuing context. The chapter begins with this affirmation, repeated affirmation, that God was with him. Take a look now at the end of the chapter in verse 21. But the Lord was with Joseph. And it was a very active with, wasn't it? Because it says, and showed him steadfast love and gave him favour in the sight of the keeper of the prison. Look at verse 23. The keeper of the prison paid no attention to anything that was in Joseph's charge. Why? Because the Lord was with him. He knew the Lord was with him. It is a mercy to be under God's blessing. And it's a rich mercy to know that that blessing is not determined by the circumstances that you have to go through. The blessing is determined by the God who walks with you through the circumstances of your daily life, with all its pressures, with all its strains. And what a mercy. He was in prison. What, that's a mercy? Yes. For the normal course was death for such a crime. And well within the power of Potiphar to have Joseph executed in that fit of rage. But instead, he sends him to prison. But what prison? The prison that Potiphar had supervision of. Pharaoh's prison. The place where royal servants were kept. A foreshadowing, is it not, as we know the remainder of the story, of what was yet to happen. For relationships will be formed there that will become pivotal for the continuing unfolding of God's providence in the life of Joseph for the protection of God's people. So, yes, a prison, yes, a dark place, but a place where God says you need to be so that you will be the man I have called you to be for the future of my kingdom. As we think of all these contexts, they help us to recognize, indeed, they require us to recognize, first of all, that here is a challenge to faith. A challenge to faith. Joseph's conscience is clear, but his life is collapsing in the wake of the nuclear-like explosion of the murderous anger of both the rejected woman and of her husband. You know, there's something scary about a person who can stare into the eyes of their loved one and lied as blatantly as she did, and manipulate her husband as cruelly and vindictively, as a pawn as she did. The Hebrew slave you brought to us. She knew where to press the trigger. It was his pride. He was one of the senior men in Pharaoh's government. You can't even look after us. You're the chief police officer. And you couldn't protect me. You trusted. And I'm the one who suffered. No wonder Pharaoh, in his anger, was explosive, intense, unbridled. He was not thinking clearly. He doesn't pick up on the fact that there's something not quite right about his wife's testimony. Bear in mind that Joseph was stronger than his wife, able to easily overpower her, to take back his garment. Joseph had shown also no hints of such a character in the past. In fact, Pharaoh's servant Potiphar continued over time to trust him and put everything ultimately in his hands because of the good character of this man. He was trustworthy, a man of integrity. He was the opposite of everything his wife was now saying. And there was no reflection on this. And while it is right for a husband to be influenced by his wife, he is unduly influenced by her in this case. And like Pilate, he opts for preserving his reputation and his position rather than pursuing the cause of truth and righteousness. There's no inquiry. There's no opportunity for defence. There is only the tossing of Joseph into prison. And there are not hints to us of the turmoil that Christ had to go through that led him ultimately to the cross set before us here. Like Joseph, he is one who unjustly suffered at the hands of man. Now, don't import, as we think of this situation, modern images of prisons back into this. Psalm 105 and verse 18 helps us to understand the nature of this new circumstance, where it says, they hurt his feet with fetters, he was laid in irons. The word here for prison in Genesis 39 is literally the round house. And the idea seems to be a circular structure that had a pole in the middle to which chains were attached. And at the other end of the chain was the prisoner. In other words, Joseph's life was to be limited to the length of the chain. And it would be marked by great discomfort and neglect that caused. This was a place, in other words, of intense deprivation as well as humiliation. Here, from the highest heights a slave could ever enjoy to the depths of suffering that prison employed, lay Joseph. But what is striking about this is that Joseph had done the right thing. He had done the right thing. He was suffering, but he suffered as an innocent. He had been obedient and reverent of God who was with him. So courageous in his loyalty to God, yet thrown into prison. That the testimony is reasserted that even here in the prison that God was with him is an indication that he was not there because he had sinned. He was not there because God was angry with him. He was not there because God somehow fell asleep and forgot about him. He was not there because Satan's will was stronger than God, his power greater than God's. No, God was with him. He had done the right thing, yet he was falsely accused. As we think of that, surely our mind thinks, well, God will now come to the rescue. God will somehow work on Potiphar, will expose the wickedness of his wife and then his own wickedness in how he responded to her, to Joseph, to the truth, to justice. Surely over time all things will be revealed, as it seems inevitably in our world. But the days turn into months and the months into years. And there was Joseph, still in prison. God was with him, but he was in prison. In prison, God was with him. How would you act? What are your expectations in relating to living and doing the right thing and finding someone slanders you, hurts you, attacks you, abuses you in some way? You've been careful in obedience to God and they've just manipulated the facts to their own advantage, but your humiliation or some other form of hurt. Would previous lessons in relation to suffering help you? Or would you, under the pressure of a new one, effectively forget everything about God's word, his teaching, and his practice in your life? How would you respond as an innocent sufferer? How have you responded? Because it happens to all of us in different ways, at different times. I believe that many would say, well, what's the point in doing the right thing? What's the point of following God in a world where sin and injustice dominate? I might as well have tasted and devoured the forbidden fruit because the end is still the same. But is it? Is it really? Is there not a clear difference between living with a guilty conscience and living with a clear conscience, even in the prison of public condemnation? Is not to live with a guilty conscience really a double prison? We are called to respond to the challenge to our faith by looking to God with faith, trusting in his perfect wisdom, that his will is good and perfect as well as acceptable. How those words from our memory verse ought to sting us. For how often do we say it's not acceptable, it's not perfect, it doesn't feel good? And yet it is. And by faith, that's what we must grasp. We must trust in his providential wisdom and in the sufficiency of his grace and also in the accuracy of his truth. That he is a God who will sustain us and support us. That's how we are to meet the challenge of faith. And secondly, we see here a realization of that faith. You know, there's nothing like a dark providence to get you to wrestle with God's word. Martin Lloyd-Jones points out on one occasion, as he was speaking from Romans 5, verses 3 to 5, he made this comment. We should glory in tribulation, not in and of itself, but because tribulation transforms our doctrine into experience, our faith into assured knowledge. You see what he's saying? There's a world of difference between knowing the theology of Romans 8:28, all things work together for good, and seeing it blossom in your experience when the rubber has hit the road under pressure to say, yes, isn't that so? God is with me. God is blessing me. God is keeping me. God knows what he's doing. God is not accountable to me. but I am to him to be an obedient son, daughter, child. Here we learn we cannot control God's providence by our godliness. All this occurred despite the practice of godliness. I'm not saying that Joseph was without sin, but there was no obvious link between a specific sin or character traits and the consequence. That is not asserted in Scripture, and we ought not to put it there. He's doing the right thing. And what we learn here is doing the right thing doesn't guarantee that other people will have a high view of us. We know that. But what we also learn here is doing the right thing does not mean we control God to do what is good for us, or what we think is good for us. It doesn't guarantee God's blessing. The Scripture makes it clear. Right is right, regardless of the context, regardless of the outcome. God calls us to obedience, and he blesses us in the context of obedience. But sometimes the blessing comes in mysterious ways that seem to have no real connection at the time to that obedience. Indeed, what we need to remember is that all that comes into our lives is by the grace of God and will be the means by which God is glorified. God doesn't owe us because we're obedient, is what I'm saying. But God will bless us, and we have no right to expect any blessing unless we're in the path of obedience. But he still doesn't owe us. It is still a grace, because ultimately when we do what is right, that's what we were created to do. And there is no reward for doing what you should do. God is not held to our obedience. Secondly, circumstances are not an automatic declaration of God's blessing or judgment. He was in prison, yet we read that the Lord showed him mercy. And we ignore that to our hurt. Yet we do it all the times, wondering what someone or what we may have done to have this happen in their lives. We forget that God, for his own purposes, sometimes gives the wicked comforts and the righteous troubles. If you doubt that, read Psalm 73 and wrestle with the psalmist. Let us not forget that not all discipline is an expression of judgment. It may be formative rather than corrective. Let us not forget that if you leave out the reality of God's eternal justice, you do so to your harm as well. Circumstances are not an automatic declaration of God's blessing or judgment. COVID has come into this world, it has touched people's lives. God is angry. You can't make that assertion. Not in those blunt terms. You can't just equate someone's suffering and say they must have done something wrong. You may be right, but you can't make that because you don't know what's in the mind of God. We live in a fallen world. It is under the curse of God. Yes, it's connected to the anger of God against unrighteousness of men. Yes. But be careful about becoming so specific. Because then you would have had to say Joseph. Or indeed, you would have to say Jesus. You died on the cross. You must have done something wrong. But we know he did nothing wrong, but for our sakes, he died upon the cross. And so we find also here hope in that God looks upon the afflictions of his people and acts with compassion. how we need to remember this. God knows what his people need in the midst of their afflictions. He's there with them. Isn't that a wonderful grace? No matter how tough it has become or is right now or may yet be, God is there to support us, showing mercy to us, pouring love out upon us, calling us to trust him. We also learn here that God is pleased and honored by the faithful endurance that his people have when they suffer for righteousness' sake. In fact, Jesus said that, didn't he? Blessed are you when you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. When they say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. He even adds, rejoice and be glad. You see, God calls us not only to trust him in and with such experiences, but to thank him for it. That's the shock I get from this passage. Can you thank God for the troubles that you are going through? That doesn't mean that the troubles aren't real, that the pain, that the anguish, that you know, that you see in others, that you treat it lightly. Far from it. You know, sin is sin. Evil is evil. We don't minimize it or its consequences. But we also know that God is here, God is at work, and he's doing something in my life, in your life. For the now, for the future, for us, for the kingdom. We are to thank him for trusting us with such, even if he never explains fully the why and only we have the generalities of scriptural truth to support our faith, to feed our faith. In fact, we are reminded that we have no right to demand of God an explanation, but he has every right to demand of us consecration. We have no right to demand of God an explanation, but he has every right to demand of us our consecration. And that leads us thirdly to see here a testimony of faith. For what surely must also strike us about the beginning of Joseph's prison life is that he maintained the same policy that he had in Potiphar's house. And that's shown by the recognition of the jailer, who then committed everything into the hand of Joseph as well. Joseph evidenced a preparedness to be a man of God, regardless of the circumstances or the change of those circumstances or the downward spiral in the change of those circumstances. He was a man of godly commitment and integrity, and he maintained that with faithfulness, but also showed the grace of patience and contentment as he trusted God to do what he would do in Joseph's life. That's the principle he acted upon at the beginning of this chapter, and it continues being central not only to this chapter but to his character. Even in prison, Joseph was a visible, vital demonstration, testimony of faith to the jailer, to the other prisoners, but also to Potiphar, who had overall jurisdiction day by day for what occurred within that prison. Faith in God, sovereign in redemption and providence, should give us the perspective that we read of Paul in Philippians 4, I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. What he said to the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians 5, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. In the Psalms, in the book of the Psalms, in Psalm 34 to 37, David focuses very much upon the innocent sufferer. He's focusing upon himself, how he has been being betrayed and abused, mistreated, in serious danger from those who have falsely accused him and seek his destruction. And yet throughout each of those psalms, he's clinging to God for deliverance. Not based upon who David is or David's place within God's promised kingdom. No. But based upon the goodness, the faithfulness, and the power of God. God's reputation, God's character, God's glory is the basis of his pleas that make praise in suffering possible and full of hope. In fact, in Psalm 34, verse 8, comes the note not only of triumphant faith, but enduring faith, as he says, "O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him." And that through this, he's speaking of the experience as an old covenant believer, and it's echoed by those in faith who sang these psalms over the centuries. Yet we know now with New Testament eyes that they preeminently portray the experience of Jesus. For he is the innocent sufferer. As I said, Joseph points us forward. The whole of the Old Testament points us forward to Jesus as the innocent sufferer for our sake. He was acknowledged by the thief on the cross as he comes to faith. He was acknowledged by the Roman centurion who pierced his heart to confirm his death. Peter tells us that Jesus underwent this for our redemption in 1 Peter 2:24. But he also stresses that in his suffering, Jesus became an example to us as to how the way of responding to wrongful suffering ourselves, so that we also will bear a testimony of faith to the glory of God. And that's the challenge, surely, that comes to us. I am in Christ. Shall I not also partake of the suffering of Christ in that sense? Not in a redemptive way, but in a declarative way of identity and of faith, of obedience and of service. Our calling as Christians is to follow in the footsteps of Christ and give testimony to God as Christ did. The testimony of faith in him, even and I would add especially so when you become an innocent sufferer at the hands of others. In response to unjust suffering, we're not to retaliate. We're not to explode in anger as Potiphar did, nor are we to sit and sulk that we may feel the force of such temptations according to our personalities. The biblical response is nonetheless the response of love. How can I honor God and bless those who are abusing me? How can I honour God and be a blessing? God has not treated us unjustly, even if others have. It is God whom we serve. It is God who cares for us. It is God who protects and guides us in times of trial, so that we don't have to face it alone, so that we don't have to deal with the arguments that this is purposeless. It is a God who makes it a time of profit, not waste. To him then be the glory. And the people of God said, Amen. Will our lives, will your life today say Amen? A Joseph Amen. A Jesus Amen. A godly Amen. Let us pray. Oh, Father, make it so in our lives. Whether we are full of freedom or suffering under deep restrictions, may it be that you will be glorified. Death as in life, may you be glorified. And we know that that will be as we walk in obedience in Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our closing praise today is 525. My Jesus, I love you. I know you are mine. 525.
My Jesus, I love you. I know you are mine. For you all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, before
forth under the blessing of our God. And now may the grace, mercy, and peace of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and forevermore. And the people of God said,
Amen. Amen.